Primal Chaos.
Hey guys, Primal Chaos here. Welcome to the channel. I was just scrolling through some videos of Lara Fabian because I realized I hadn't done anything from her in a little while. And, you know, I really respect her work as an artist. And I mean, you know, the stuff I've done on the channel has been absolutely stunning. As I was scrolling through, I came across a video for a song that I hadn't heard in many, many, many years. An album came out in the, I guess, the mid-90s, I suppose, Falling Into You by Celine Dion, which I became obsessed with at one point just simply because the production was so stunning. Whether I'm a Celine fan or not is purely up for debate. You know, some of her songs sound amazing. She's obviously a phenomenal vocalist as well. But, you know, it's definitely adult contemporary music, and young Corey in his early 20s. It wasn't so much about Celine Dion, if you get my drift. It was more about the production of a perfect pop record at the time. And as someone who's always been interested in writing music and having, you know, a home studio and all that sort of stuff, listening to an album like that with just absolutely flawless work is something to aspire to. And I've always been the kind of person where I'm not ashamed of liking anything as long as it's for a decent reason, right? And that's what it was with her. But look, Celine is a brilliant, world-class vocalist. Much along the lines of, like, if you're trying to explain to somebody who is Lara Fabian and they may not be familiar, you say, well, she's very similar, I guess, in many different regards to Celine Dion in her, I mean, to a degree, her timbre, but, you know, her range and all that sort of stuff as well. Adult contemporary vibe, that sort of thing. They don't sound alike, but if you were trying to compare them to anything, you know, it's like if you were trying to explain to somebody, oh, they're a female-fronted new metal band, they're like, what does that mean? Well, so have you heard Evanescence? It's that kind of thing, right? So I was scrolling through and I came across this one, and it's all coming back to me now, which was off that album. So I'm familiar with it, obviously. But I hadn't seen the video, at least not that I can recall. And I wanted to run through it because, one, I haven't heard Celine in a really long time. And I'd be interested, now that I've done so much active listening, that's what I call it. When I'm doing reactions, it's a little bit different to just listening to a song because I'm so actively listening. I tend to find things to focus on that I never would listen to if I was listening passively, which is why I don't mind going over and doing a few reactions to songs that I've heard before, because I'm often so surprised with stuff I didn't even know was there or concepts that I hadn't considered before, because I'm always trying to cherry pick things out to give to you guys as part of that whole extra value of what I like to produce, you know, these reaction videos for. I like to give you guys more than you came in with, right? So in this one in particular, it sort of struck me, a lot of things sort of fell into place in my mind. I'm like, wait a minute, this is a Jim Steinman song. Now, if you're not familiar, Jim Steinman is the guy who wrote almost all of Meatloaf's music. In fact, probably all of it. I'm not 100% sure, but, you know, all that Bat Out of Hell 1, Bat Out of Hell 2, it was all Jim Steinman pushed through the prism of Meatloaf. I Would Do Anything for Love, But I Won't Do That, was a Meatloaf song that was actually recorded on Bat Out of Hell 2 in place of this song. So this is what makes it really interesting. I thought there's, even if it's not a reaction video, there's a lot to talk about here. It's kind of interesting. So Meatloaf heard It's All Coming Back to Me Now, said, okay, this sounds amazing. I'd love to record this. Jim Steinman said, no, what we'll do, we'll hold off till Bat Out of Hell 3, which came out like a really long time after. And Meatloaf did, in fact, record a version of this. But in the time frame, he said, no, don't record this song. We'll record that later on your third album. And in the meantime, suddenly Celine Dion is releasing this song on her album Falling Into You. So Meatloaf, obviously annoyed, attempted to sue Jim Steinman over it. Didn't end up, nothing ended up coming out of it. But it's an interesting story about these two, like, you know, composer and artist, you know, very similar to Igor and Dimash, right? Imagine if they had a conflict where Dimash was like, I'd love to record that song. He's like, no. And then he went and gave it to Lara Fabian to record, you know? It's kind of interesting. So another thing that's really interesting, if you look at the music video for It's All Coming Back to Me Now and I Would Do Anything for Love, the tone of them is almost identical. Like the visual style, the aesthetic, you'll see this in a minute when I play it. And it's funny because I looked it up. The guy who actually made this one, I'm not sure if he made the other video, but they look very similar, is a guy named Nigel Dick, I think. And he also did some videos at the time that I'm also really familiar with, like Guns N' Roses videos. I think he might have done Estranged, maybe. I'll have to look into it. But there's definitely things I can remember from that era where I was like, this totally fits the aesthetic of what he was producing at the time. I've talked enough. Let's listen to the let's listen and check out the song, because it's been a really long time for me. But I'll be talking a little bit about the video too, because I'm not super familiar with it. Interesting. I love a song that has the audacity to start with a. In fact, it's more like a. Very cool. It's like to me, that's always been a bold statement. It's like Muse Absolution starts with like a sort of. Oh, samples don't go that low. Or whatever it is, you know, it's got this bombastic sort of thing, which I'm a big fan of. I really, really dig that. So let's jump back. There's like a little shuffle on a cello or something. So much drama, so much light and shade in Chimp's playing. It's always amazing to listen to. See that right there, that's just a masterclass in light and shade from a vocalist, right? One thing that I was always really impressed with Celine was her acuity. She's always perfectly on pitch unless she's deliberately not, right? And she has this sort of edge to her belts that's sort of just this driving force, but still without sounding harsh or abrasive. There's a little bit of nasal sort of tone there. I think that's the Canadian, French-Canadian sort of... She's French-Canadian, right? Yeah. You know, her language a little bit. It's kind of like that same thing with Italian singers and opera singers and things like that. But then, you know, she takes this hard edge to really drive that home, and her timing is impeccable. She's never late to a note, and she never arrives too early. She's precisely where she needs to be. And she also has flavor and feel as well, which is tough. You know, you can either be a robot or you can be too loose. She's right bang where she needs to be. And then you've got this, she brings it right back to this whisper sort of, you know, completely different register. Every lick is just pristine, you know? Drama, right? You touch me like this, and you hold me like that. I just have to admit that it's all coming back to me. Sounds like a lullaby, right? I touch you like this, and I hold you like that. It's so hard to believe, but it's all coming back to me. It's is that what a sleigh bell kind of thing? Like it's like a tambourine, but it sounds like it's bells instead. You know, those bell tree kind of tambourine things. Again, this has this flavor of this Beauty and the Beast aesthetic, right? When you see the shadow of him coming over, he almost looks like a character from Beauty and the Beast. And that's the whole aesthetic of I Would Do Anything for Love, is that Beauty and the Beast sort of thing. It's so weird how they're, you know, this, I don't know who borrowed from who, because I can't remember the time frames when these songs came out, but it almost looks like two songs from a concept album playing into the same video, like the same, you know, it's a soundtrack to a particular movie or something. You know, it's wild how similar they are. But it's all coming back to me when I touch you like this and I hold you like that. It's so hard to believe, but it's all coming back to me. It's all coming back, it's all coming back to me now. There were moments of gold. That's what's always struck me as great with her voice. When she comes up to those high notes, it's she just has this beautiful compression, which just has this sort of it's like, what's the word? It's just got this sort of, in guitar terminology, you talk about it. It's like it breaks up beautifully with like a saturation, where it's not a pristine bell type sound. It's more like an electric guitar playing a high note. And some of that's the reverb as well, how it sort of sits in the reverb and becomes more lush than it is. It might actually, if you heard it in person, sound a little bit more shrill, but in context of this sort of a mix, you hear these notes just sort of like disappearing into just this noise that's just really pleasant to listen to. Laws Allow, I think there's the notes. Right there. Funny, I was reading a little bit from Nigel, who directed the music video, and his interview, because it was obviously fairly recent, someone asked him about it, and it came off as a little bit sort of like, that one, yeah. Like, as in, it wasn't terrible to make, but he goes, as far as it was the first film he'd done that had sort of cutting-edge visual effects for the time. And, I mean, you got to remember, this came out roughly around the time is like Terminator 2, right? So digital effects and things like that were really in their infancy. But he was like, oh yeah, no, I think I'd be a lot more proud of this if I'd have made it like 10 years later or, you know, whatever. But if you look at all this chroma key stuff, it's actually not too bad. It's pretty world-class for the time. Like, you could put this in a feature film and people wouldn't be walking out of there going, what the hell did we just watch? You know, at the time. Guitar coming in is just great. You need me like that. It was that long ago, but it's all coming back to me. It's so hard to resist, and it's all coming back to me. It's just so Beauty and the Beast, right? Am I crazy? There's that sound again. Those licks, that's right, I remember. This is part of the reason, like I said, you know, I wasn't super into Celine Dion at the time. I was into the production and stuff, but there's something about her licks, and maybe it's coming from like a guitarist perspective, because she sings like a guitarist plays lead guitar. You know, those little like perfect little, but it's not going back. those little embellishments and things. It's perfect. But at the same time, she has the grace to be able to sing a melody, right? Which is something that's lost on so many singers that can sing licks. Just because you can doesn't mean you should, right? Some of the greatest guitar solos in history are melodic and they follow the pattern of the vocal, but they'll throw in little tiny embellishments and artistic flourishes that make it important and make it seem different and engaging and not boring. And so this is what Celine does great. She sings the melody, and then when it's time to execute some sort of a flourish or an extravagance, then she knows when to lay on the heat and when to pull it back. And so many singers, particularly in the modern times, could really take something away from that, right? Everybody wants to be able to sing those licks, but what they should be learning is when not to sing them. Easy.
And with those empty threats and hollow lies, and whenever you try to hurt me, I just hurt you even worse than so much deeper.
There were hours,
that's just when I fought days. When alone at last we count up all the chances that will last to us forever.
I love that I recorded those backings because I think it's a guy, or at least a mix of guy, female, male voices. But it's just so interesting. It's another way of sort of punctuating it. It's like, okay, we're this far along in the song because that part does repeat a little bit. And so you want to have something slightly different. In the first one, it was a little guitar lick. In the second one, it was those forever vocals. Actually, that's another thing I'm noticing. There's all this really kooky orchestral percussion throughout this that I never noticed before. Like there's one of those little woodblock things that you hit and it makes a clicking sound. That was in there earlier. And these, you know, this big orchestral sort of sounding percussion hits. Sounds like you dropped a piano off a cliff, you know? Sound again, and it just dissolves into just beautiful saturation.
If you like this, and if you kiss me like that, it was so long ago, but it's all coming back to me. If you touch me like this, and if I kiss you like that, it was gone with the wind, but it's all coming back to me. It's all coming.
Musical production, right? Sounds like a Broadway song.
Me all this, if I forgive you We forgive and forget, and it's all coming back to me. When you see me like this, and when I see you like that, we see just what we want to see all coming back to me. The flesh and the fantasies all coming back to me. I can barely recall, but it's all coming back
wow.
to me.
It's all coming back to me now.
Love how he reintroduces the motif from the chorus in the outro keys. So good.
And when I touch you like that,
it's all coming back to me now.
And if you do it like this,
it's all coming back to me now.
And if we
come on, what an opus. It's look, it's 90s and it's cheesy and all that, but my God, like what an achievement for the time and what a beautifully stunning and dramatic song. I'm going to jump into a break, and when I come back, let's break this thing down. Hey guys, today's video is brought to you in part by Skillshare. Now, anyone who knows me will tell you that I have way too many interests and hobbies. I'm also what's known as an autodidact, which means I'm largely self-taught, but my interests vary wildly amongst an entire gamut of disciplines. Disciplines ranging from things like music production, composition, video production, YouTube content creation, 3D printing, 3D modeling, electronics, woodworking, drawing, painting, graphic design, computers and code. The list just goes on and on. And in order to become proficient in all of these disciplines, it's taken me a lifetime of skills gathered piecemeal here, there, and everywhere. By and large, it just takes so long to develop a skill level in any of those individual things. But it ain't the old days anymore. And today we've got services like Skillshare, a service that provides you with near limitless amounts of information for one small subscription fee. Seriously, all of their curated learning modules and lessons and classes, they're all available at your fingertips. What if you're a graphic designer and then one day you just need to learn something very specific in the world of spreadsheets? Your Skillshare account has you covered. And the courses are all curated, meaning that there's a standard level of competency required for anyone to be teaching a course. And the best part about all this is Skillshare offers free trials. So all you need to do is click the link in the description. It'll take you to their site and you can start learning right now. Or, you know, like wait till after my video. But either way, look, Skillshare. All right, so one thing I really liked about that and a lot about Jim Steinman's stuff is that it's not just ephemeral songwriting noise, right? It's always a story. He's a storyteller in much the same way like someone like Bob Dylan is. Bob Dylan wasn't the greatest singer in the world, but boy, could he tell a story, right? And Jim Steinman would, you know, he comes up with a concept and he writes an opus around what that is. And you can see that illustrated writ large with this composition. So apparently this was based on Wuthering Heights, which I'm not super familiar with, but you know, a lot of people will associate that with Kate Bush, who's in the news all over the place lately. Congratulations on that payday, girl. There's a lot to be said for keeping your catalog as your own, right? She's laughing all the way to the bank right now. But Wuthering Heights is apparently tragic, and you know, there's a scene in it where, you know, the protagonist digs up his dead wife and dances with her on the beach and things like that. Like it's a whole thing. So apparently he based that on this, he based this on the darker parts of Wuthering Heights. And, you know, but again, regardless, he's obviously taken that concept and he's written something here, and it's about essentially a lost love that then evolves over time where she keeps on having to relive, you know, this experience of seeing him everywhere, everywhere she looks, there's reminders. You know, there's always this ghostly presence of him hovering around, you know, always like making her never be able to heal, essentially, because the reminders are always there. And as the song progresses, you know, you get that major lift after the bridge. You know, it sort of it boils down and down and down. And then eventually it has this major lift where all of a sudden the attitude shifts and it becomes a bit more self-confident in its sound. And you see the expression on her face change from one of loss and desire and longing to one of a self-confident woman who's starting to evolve out of that grieving process. And you can see that, I mean, it's in the song, but you know, the video clip actually does a really good job of displaying that as well. And eventually he starts to fade into the background and she starts becoming more and more present and more of an individual standing on her own feet. And that's kind of where the song goes. But what a beautiful sort of concept for a song in the first place, and beautifully executed. But man, is it a little bit pompous and stuff in its execution? Sure it is. It's big, it's brash. It's almost like I was saying throughout, it's like a big Broadway song. You know, like in the third act, where finally the heroine of the piece starts to develop her own autonomy and her own life and sort of push on and, you know, lead towards a happy ending. That's what this is in like a 7 minute song. You know, I just realized how long it is. Wow. It's like seven and a half minutes. It's amazing that this was a single, right? They must have cut it down. Like, again, around this time, they also had songs like November Rain by Guns N' Roses. And every time they'd play that music video, they'd chop off the second guitar solo and onwards, you know? So maybe they had a truncated version of this for music video shows and stuff. I wouldn't be surprised. But, you know, I was sort of thinking that. I'm like, man, haven't we been over this territory? As I was listening to it, there's like parts that seemed like they were kind of a little bit ephemeral, but it needs to be played in its entirety to really get the gist of the emotional roller coaster ride that it takes you on. You know, I really wish this was something that was produced now, only because if, you know, with the same heart and the same energy and everything, not like to be like, you know, to suddenly have a whole different aesthetic and everything. It'd just be interesting to hear this done in a way where you're sort of taken out of the equation of like, this is early 90s or mid 90s or something, where there's an aesthetic to it that seems kind of schmaltzy and, it's like the cover of a romance novel, which was all the rage back then. That was kind of a flavor back then. And you had all of these sort of romantic schmaltzy artists, like to a degree Celine, but you had guys like Fabio walking around and Michael Bolton and guys like that. It was all about romance and pirate shirts and, you know, this sort of romance novel aesthetic, you know? So I'd love to have heard this produced. I mean, maybe, you know, Battle to Hell 3 came out in 2006, I think. So it'd be interesting to hear how it compares with Meatloaf singing, but and what they might have done differently. But this is it's a historical piece of literature, you know, that's worth revisiting in the context of its time, right? But man, Celine, what a voice! Like, just she's just magical to listen to. There's a reason that she fits into this genre specifically at this time as well, because her voice is a romance novel. It really is. And, you know, the way she looks and the you know, her ability to act out this scenario and everything, it just all plays into this whole dramatic theater kind of larger than life production value kind of thing, you know. But, you know, I'm glad I checked this out because, first of all, it's an interesting story to tell, you know, with the concept of it and how, you know, the back and forth with Meatloaf and how it compares to I Would Do Anything for Love, which, like I said, go and check out my reaction to that one because that was super emotional. And I feel like that video, because of the algorithm blocking it, it didn't get the respect it deserved, especially with the passing of Meatloaf happening just like days prior, you know? So, you know, that was an experience and it's a magical video. You should go watch it regardless. Just even if you don't watch mine, go watch Meatloaf. And also give Celine some love, check out some of her stuff. A lot of you watching this probably come from that background of like being interested in Lara Fabian or Dimash or, you know, more classical inspired or operatic singers. So if you've made it this far, I'm assuming you're one of those people. Hit me up in the comments. Let me know who else I should be checking out. But yeah, this was really good. I'm glad I did this journey. I wasn't expecting this to be as fruitful as it was. It was very cool. But anyway, if you feel like I brightened your day at all, feel free to support the channel just by buying me a coffee or just leave, I'll leave a link in the description or just hit the thanks button below the video. It's YouTube's way of allowing you to support creators without leaving the app. So that's cool. Like, share, follow, subscribe, send this to anyone you think might be interested in checking it out. And yeah, I'll catch you guys on the next one. I'm going to go listen to some heavy metal to cleanse the palate. Thanks, guys. Catch you later.